The hour of our official departure had come. The last interviews were given, the last photographs taken. And we were on a... The Place de la Concorde in Paris, gray on this February morning, bitter cold on the windswept mountains of Spain. The rock of Gibraltar faced us across the bay. We were on the docks of Algeciras, and again our trucks swung from fragile-looking cables for the short crossing of the straits, which would take us to Spanish Morocco. A week after leaving Brussels, we were on African soil. Ceuta, where we land, has modern docks and a modern ramp to lead into the ancient city. But soon we strike inland and enter another world. We are approaching the sacred city of Moulay Idriss. It is the time of the Grand Musim, a famous yearly Mohammedan festival. The wealthy Arabs have come on magnificent Arabian horses. Pilgrims flock into the city in thousands. And already, the fantasias have begun. See them go, the finest horses and the finest horsemen in the world. Entertainers come to the city from all over Morocco. The solemn fire dancers who hold burning coals in their hands and produce lighted torches, flowing sleeves. The fire eaters who breathe in flames and smoke and assure the credulous pilgrims that fire is their only diet. And see this fellow. He is only breaking bottles. But wait. He does not break them as you and I. This is a bed he is making. He is very tired and wants to take a beauty rest nap. And see this one. He is not tired, but hungry. No fire for him. Nothing will satisfy him but well-blended broken bottle. What an idea for a breakfast food. And here is a snake charmer as daring as those of India. This is the African black cobra, as vicious and as deadly as the Indian cobras. Drums and flute provide the hypnotic music. A formidable barrier of mountains separates the fertile plains of Morocco from the barren wastes of the Sahara Desert. Here in Africa are huge cedars and pines and often heavy snow. We had left Europe in winter and had had bitterly cold nights in the mountains of Spain. We were back again in snow and ice, and in our first camp in the Atlas, the water in our radiators froze and we had to chip ice off the windshields. Africa is a country of contrasts. Look at this hooded figure, passing in a setting so unfamiliar. Look at the telephone lines, for we are still on a thoroughly modern road, the military road across the Atlas Mountains, superbly engineered and built by the French Foreign Legion for the opening up of France's huge African empire. Away once more, we are now swiftly going down the southern side of the mountain range. We learn to appreciate good hydraulic brakes on roads like these. In less than 4 hours, we will pass from a temperature well below freezing to the almost intolerable heat of desert. At 6 in the morning, we were struggling in snow and ice. At 11, we are in the Zeist Valley and the temperature has reached 110. Reject from your minds all you ever heard about the Sahara being just one huge ocean of sand. There is in the Sahara every kind of barren and forbidding landscape. Huge rocky cliffs, mountain ranges, tumbled masses of rock. In the red of the sand dunes, deep blue of the sky. For several hundreds of miles before we enter the absolutely barren desert, they will dot our course. And rough tracks, hard on tires, but easy enough going for our powerful dodges, connect them with civilization. The sands are never still. The slightest breeze lifts and carries a fine golden powder, which comes rippling down the sides of the dunes and slowly in the course of centuries alters their outline. Old Saharians tell you, the dunes are smoking, and they refer to the light fringe of sand which the wind is blowing off the top of the dunes. Too often, the forerunner of terrifying and disastrous sandstorms. In every one of these oasis outposts, the French have a garrison of colonial troops. It is a marvelous sight to see these horsemen galloping by in their brilliant uniforms, mounted on Arabian horses especially trained to the soft sand of the desert. Their officers are the finest men of the French army, inured as hard as their men to the long marches under a burning sun and to the thirst of the desert. It is not many years since the desert was infested with lawless bands of Tuareg pillagers, and these lonely outposts were in constant danger of attack. This very one stood a heroic and bloody siege. Discipline as strict as that of the finest cavalry schools of Europe prevails here, many hundreds of miles from France, among these hard-bitten desert men. And now we are leaving the last of the roads behind us. Before us stretches the desert, hundreds of miles of sand and gravel, sometimes firm and smooth so that we can make good time, sometimes perfectly hard under a thin covering of soft sand, sometimes soft and without bottom under a thin hard crust which suddenly gives way under the wheels. There is in the Sahara every kind of sand, and weeks of experience will not teach you where a surface, which is to all appearances hard, will unexpectedly give way. The dreaded rotten earth is the worst, as fluid and slippery as talcum powder. Sometimes, as we shoveled and sweated, a camel caravan would pass, and how scornfully the camels would look at us. They had no 6-ton load to carry, however, and no 4-ton trailer to pull. We had been many times assured that the attempt to pull a 4-ton trailer across the Sahara was lunacy, and I came close to believing it. With their terrible overload, the Dodge trucks took almost unbelievable punishment. Remember that they did this day after day for hundreds of miles in a temperature of 120 to 130 degrees. Our progress was at times dishearteningly slow. On our worst day, we did like this in 12 hours, less than 100 yards. And then, sometimes when we least expected it, the wheels would suddenly bite, pull out. We would change into second, into high, creep up to 35, 40. The secret of Sahara driving is at all costs to keep up speed on tires deflated to less than half normal pressure. We were now picking up our supplies for the second leg of the trip. From now on, we were to give up our comfortable Pullman installations in the trucks. The trailer discarded, we were filling the trucks to the roof with cases of gasoline, long ago sent here for us by camel caravan. Every item was to be checked over and over. Food and water for 20 days, 300 gallons of water. The greater part of the desert still lay before us. But we felt we were veterans of the Sahara, and that nothing would stop us. 1 ton of gasoline in each truck. From now on, we would sleep on the ground. We'd given the little boys cigarettes and pennies, and they hated to see us go. But the town was preparing to give us a send-off in the manner of the Sahara. As we drove, the crowd around us grew, and soon the sand and gravel kicked up with the flying hoofs of the horses made me fear for our windshield. In the heavy sand, we tried vainly to overtake the furiously galloping horses.